Rev up your engine! Today I'm going to show you how to find hard-to-find exhaust leaks. Very easy to use machines. Take the top off. Get some mineral oil. Pour a little inside. Pretty simple operation. Put the top back on. Then you hook it up to a battery. One there. One there. And after a very short period of time, smoke comes out, which we stick in the exhaust system. Just make sure you do it on an exhaust system that's cooled down. They can get really hot. You don't want anything to start on fire, so do it on a cold motor like this. Just stick in the exhaust pipe and plug it up. This is dual, so we gotta put it in both sides. Now with the car jacked up in the air, get a jack stand on the map, throw it under here. Now first we'll look under the hood after it's been running a few minutes. We don't see any smoke, and I don't smell any up here, so let's crawl under and look. This car doesn't have that many miles on it. You can see the exhaust system. It's got a lot of stainless in it. There's nothing leaking yet. So we're following the whole way up, past the cat, up to the front, and there's no smoke coming out anywhere. So, in this case, there's no obviously big static leaks that are just sitting there leaking from relatively large holes, because you got to understand the smoke machine. It's flowing, but the pressure, it's less than 1 pound per square inch. Any large leak, it's going to push it out a large leak, but it's less than 1 pound per square inch pressure. So since the engine's cold now, what we're going to do is start it up, take off these gloves, and start feeling under there. So we'll go inside. Make sure that handbrake is nice and tight. I pulled it before, but I'm going to make it a little bit tighter. I don't want it rolling. Put it in neutral, push down the clutch, and start her up. Make sure it's in neutral. Now running, the engine puts out a lot more than 1 PSI. So when I take my glove off and feel around under the car, I may be able to feel leaks that are only going to occur when it's got real strong pressure, not just the little bitty half a pound from the smoke machine, but the engine exhaust. So we'll go under again and start feeling. As I feel around, aha, I feel a leak coming out right here. And here is a real big tip. It's wet here. So you might think, what the heck does it mean that it's wet there? Well, that means that's definitely where the leak is. When you burn gasoline, which is hydrogen and carbon, in Earth's atmosphere, using nitrogen and oxygen and the trace elements that's in our Earth's atmosphere, one of the byproducts is water. Check out your car some morning. Start it up if it's sat a while. You'll see water dripping out of the back of the exhaust. It's just a byproduct, and there's always a little bit of water. So the fact that this thing has water on that connector, that engine water isn't making it the whole way back out the tailpipe. It's coming out right there. And there's a clamp there. These things are notorious for vibrations, and the clamp's just loose. So we're gonna check that. So we get our sockets and a ratchet, crawl back under there and see if we can tighten it up.
Look at this, a wild guess. I guess 16 millimeter. Fits on perfectly.
So we get our ratchet, put it on, and what happens when we tighten it? Ah, it's loose as can be.
Just tighten this baby up.
And here we go. Tight as can be. Now we'll start it up again. Crawl back up, push on the clutch again because it's a standard. Push that button. Let's check it out now. We'll take the glove off again. Got to chew it off. I'm using the camera with the other hand. Go back under, and as we get back to where the leak was, we put our hands in, voila! We no longer feel any air escaping. So, it was a loose clamp. The guys at the John Cooper Works put on the fancy exhaust system, didn't tighten it up when they built it. Now, sure, these engines vibrate a little more, some of it would have vibrated, but take that Toyota there, that thing is 9 years older. Never had to tighten up any exhaust. Never leaked. At least it was a simple fix. Now it isn't often that something is this easy to fix, but hey, if you follow me and do it yourself, you're not gonna get ripped off. Who knows what they would have told him at a dealer, what he needed. I've had customers go there and they say, oh, you need a new catalytic converter, you need new this, new that. You could see once we were under it, that exhaust system's got a lot of stainless steel in it. It's shiny as can be, it's not rotten or anything. Who knows what they would have tried to sell you? If you figured out yourself, hey, unless you're crazy, you're not gonna rip yourself off. Now even though the smoke machine didn't show us where the leak was because it needed extra pressure. It did allow us to forget a lot of things that it could possibly be. So then we had to concentrate on, okay, it's going to be a pretty small leak because it needs the extra pressure of the engine running. And in that case, it's always best to check any joints. And they'll often only leak after a while or under pressure like this one. This is great for the first check because if you see holes, big things, ta-da, simple. But when it doesn't find it, now you know how to test them under pressure using the car's engine. So now you know how to find and fix exhaust leaks on your car. So you can go back to having fun driving it around. And here's some bonus questions and answers. Well, a bunch of people in Boulder, Colorado, boy, they were in for a surprise when they went to the gas station. At Circle K gas station there, somebody mistakenly put diesel fuel in the gasoline underground tanks. So these people were pumping diesel in their car. If you don't know it, tanks in the back, right? So you got all the line going to the fuel injectors. Unfortunately, the car started because there was still that residual gasoline. But after a few blocks, out they went with diesel in a gasoline engine. Well, I guess it could have been worse. They could have put gasoline in a diesel engine. It would have destroyed the engines. They would have blown up. But still, in a modern car, it can do a lot of damage putting the wrong fuel in. Now, the Circle K company's paying one woman $1,200 for the pair she had to get. And now they say they're looking at all the other ones. But I mean, I've seen that before. I've seen guys go to convenience stores that had bad gas and they didn't take any responsibility at all for it. They can be real stinkers with that. Which is one reason I tell people all the gasoline is basically made in one place in most areas. Then additives are added. The refinery, there's usually only one kind of refinery that makes the fuel. Then other companies may add additives to it. But gasoline that you want to buy is one, a controlled station, and you're really better off buying them from the companies themselves. You want Exxon, go to Exxon. You want Shell, go to Shell. Because those are being sold at their stations, their gas. If there is a problem, you got a good recourse. A huge oil company that has billions of dollars. I mean, look at BP here in the Gulf Coast. The BP had that big oil leak and fire. It cost them a whole bunch of money, billions. But it was only a tiny, 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 tiny percentage of their profit. So you get a $2,000 repair, that ain't anything to them. You know, they got to think twice. It's one reason it's better to stick to a name-branded place where you've got recourse. Now, like I said, the gasoline itself, hey, they're all made in the same place. But once they're put in and you got some clown at a Circle K putting it in the wrong tank, whew, at least you'd have much better recourse if it was a big company. They'd know they made a mistake, it would be seen, and then you wouldn't have to deal with such a headache as dealing with a convenience store chain. Diesel Dan 88 says, Scotty, I have a 2015 Jeep Cherokee Trailhawk V6, 87,000 miles. I inherited it. At 85,000 miles, I had the bank rocker rollers and both camshafts replaced under warranty. There's a few more months left on that. The transmission hasn't extended one more year. It clunked. It's not shifting right. I'm considering replacing the transmission for $4,200. Should I drive it and let it wreck, or should I try to fix it? Me, I'd try to sell it right now. Look at that. You know, the mileage, they had to replace the cams and the engine. That shows you the absolute crap that Jeep is putting out these days. Just junk that the cams wore out on a car. Luckily, they fixed it under warranty, right? I'd either get rid of it right now, or if you want to drive it, just drive until the wheels fall off and then junk it. It might not be that far in the future that the wheels fall off, or the transmission starts shifting entirely. You know, so what the heck? You said you got a year left on the tranny warranty, even though they won't fix it. Now, if it finally doesn't even move the vehicle, they would have to fix it. So what the heck? Drive the heck out of it. Maybe the transmission will burn out while it's still under the next year warranty. And then you have a free transmission. That's what I do. And then if they replace it for free, great. You know, you get it for free. And then if it doesn't break before then, and it does finally break after the warranty, then just junk it. But don't put any of your own money into the stupid thing and junk. Freddy Federalist says, I got a 2013 Kia Rio 1.6 liter. My transmission slips in higher gears and it has the code P0734 gear 4 incorrect ratio. All right, I hate to bust your bubble, but unfortunately, every single
Kia that I've ever worked on. That code with the slipping in higher gears, gear four and correct ratio, the transmission was shot inside and it needed to be completely overhauled, a rebuilt transmission installed, or if you feel lucky gambling, rolling a dice, try a used transmission from a salvage yard. Those are weak transmissions to begin with in 2013 in a Kia Rio, and when they do that, and they're going out, you got to decide, do you want to spend a lot of money and put a rebuilt transmission in it? Do you want to just sell it as is? Or do you want to gamble with the used transmission? That decision you got to make yourself. But I can guarantee you dollars to donuts, the transmission itself is shot with what it's doing in that particular code. Because every time I've seen that code on one of those, they were wearing out internally and needed a whole rebuild. It's never something simple like it's low on fluid or something. It's just shot internally.
So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.